Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Analog to Digital Conversion Methods, Dual Slope Conversion. Okay, in our previous lecture about flash conversion, I said it was one of my favorite methods because it's so fast and so simple. The drawbacks is a lot of use of hardware. The dual slope conversion is also my favorite method of analog to digital conversion because it doesn't use a lot of hardware and it gets major extra points because it's using existing hardware we've already discussed in a pretty cunning fashion to make things happen. Yes, it takes a little bit longer, and no, it's not as simple to understand as flash, but it makes the use of some very limited resources to make this thing happen. Before we get into how dual slope works, is what I want to do is just go over the general diagram, which I've drawn right here for a dual slope conversion. And it looks confusing right now, but let's take each part in turn and discuss how these things work on an individual basis. And then what we'll go ahead and do is figure out how they all work in concert. Over here on the left-hand side, it's just a simple switch. What controls the switch? Well, obviously the control unit. It's telling it to switch to the V in. Okay, that's my analog input voltage, which I am going to go ahead and try to sample and somehow generate a digital output. Where is my digital output coming from? Right there. So that's my in, that's my out. What is this switch switching back and forth between? Well, if there's an analog input voltage on one side, there is a negative reference voltage on the other side. Okay, it has to be negative for this thing to work. Okay, on the control, at a certain time, it's going to tell it to switch, okay, perhaps a time where it's, okay, sample that input voltage, at which point something might be charging up, hint, hint, switch it over, and at some point, something might discharge, hint, hint, to that negative reference voltage there, and it's going to flip-flop back and forth between them and measure the time, okay? Hence the use of a counter. Okay, so I'm already hinting at what's going on here. All right, what's this device next to it that looks kind of like an operational amplifier with a little bit of feedback? Well, it's kind of like an operational amplifier with a little bit of feedback. Notice that feedback resistor, however, has been replaced with a capacitor. This operational amplifier behaves exactly like the operational amplifier I mentioned in the flash conversion method, where the inverting and the non-inverting inputs are being held at the same potential, and property number two is no current can enter the operational amplifier. If no current is entering the operational amplifier and the non-inverting input is being held at ground, i.e. 0 volts, what's the inverting input at? Well, perhaps at 0 volts. So when that analog input voltage, the switch is being sampling that input voltage there, there's a voltage gradient from VN to 0 across the input resistor R. What happens? Well, obviously current flows through that resistor. Due to property number 2 of operational amplifiers, no current can enter the operational amplifier. Where does it go? It goes into the capacitor, and it starts charging the capacitor up. So you see what's going on here. We'll come back to that in a little bit here. What's this device? The output of that integrator is called an integrator or a ramp generator. Where is the output of that integrator or ramp generator being fed to? Well, it's being fed to a comparator, a very simple comparator that's comparing the output of that integrator or ramp generator to 0. As long as the output of the ramp generator is less than 0, that comparator will have a 1 output, i.e. it's true. Because again, what is our non-inverting input being held at? 0 volts. So it's constantly comparing that other input with 0 volts. If there's a 1 on the output of the comparator, what is it being fed to? Well, it's being fed into this AND gate, which is other input is the clock. So it's almost like it's a clock enable. So when there's an output of high on that comparator, what's the output of the AND gate? Well, it's very simply the clock. So those pulses are reaching the counter, and that's exactly what our next device here is, our counter. What's it going to do? It's going to count up. When it's counting up at a certain point, it's going to reach a maximum, which I've called terminal count here. It could be some other number besides terminal count, but that's what I'm trying to say. It's a maximum or the terminal count, or in general purposes, an N, some number. Okay, there's a fixed count, at which point that fixed count is being fed back to the control unit via that line right there. Control unit is going to make a decision to potentially clear out that counter at a certain point. And then it may even make a decision at this point to go ahead and switch over to that reference voltage, that negative reference voltage value, at which point we could use this counter again in a different fashion. And at a certain point, it's going to count up, at which point the control will go ahead and enable the register and pull information from that that counter and send it on to the register and send it on its merry way to its output. Despite the fact that I haven't gone into great detail of how these things work individually, just by looking at the block diagram here, we've already kind of come up a figure how we're doing it. And what I've really hinted to is these two stages right here. There are two stages for a dual slope conversion, obviously. There's a fixed count stage where there's a variable slope while the capacitor charges up. And additionally, there's a second stage where there's a variable count but a fixed slope while it discharges. To illustrate what I'm talking about here, is just look at these two little graphs I've drawn. I know I haven't gone into the output of the integrator just yet, but let's say there's a certain input voltage, which if we have a fixed count, okay, you can only charge up for this long. If there's a certain value that it charges up to in that period, it's going to charge to there. In this particular case, it's negative. You'll see in a little bit here why. Whereas if I hooked it to a greater magnitude of input voltage, let's say the second time I do it in red here, it's going to charge at a faster rate because it's a greater voltage, but it's still going to charge for the same amount of time. Does that make sense? This time period here that it's given to charge is always fixed. That variable that you hook up to, the input variable, the input voltage, that's different. That could be whatever. If it's lesser, if it's a small value, despite the fact that you've given it a fixed amount of time to charge up, it's not going to charge up very much. Whereas if you give it a fixed amount of time and hook it up to a big voltage, it's going to charge up faster. So what we have here is a fixed count with a variable slope. Notice this slope, rise over run, is smaller than this slope, rise over run. So that's the first stage. What's the second stage? Well, basically, it's a fixed slope while it discharges. While this capacitor discharges, what we have is a fixed slope. Regardless of what the voltage is, it has a fixed slope while it discharges. Same thing here. In the second case, despite the fact that it was a higher voltage there, it has a fixed slope. You already see what's going on here. Look at this. That time difference, time 2 versus time 1. Time 2 is substantially longer than time 1. Why? Well, because it was charged up to a higher voltage. Well, in this particular case, higher negative voltage. Does that make sense? So that time 1 is proportional to a smaller voltage, and that time 2 is proportional to a larger voltage. And think about time. I'm measuring time with a counter. That is when the output from the counter, okay, in this particular case, let's say it's 0011, and this particular case, it's 0111. It took 3 milliseconds to finally discharge versus 7 milliseconds to discharge. It is proportional to the height of that voltage. And what we've got here is, again, it's a variable count with a fixed slope. It's opposite world. So that is the dual slope behind the dual slope conversion method. First time, fixed count right here, fixed, but variable slope proportional to the voltage that you are in fact sampling at that input moment. Second stage, it's a variable count with a fixed slope while it discharges. So let's go into the internal workings of this particular device here. And let's start off with a case where the capacitor is fully discharged, the input voltage is connected, the switch switches over to the input voltage, and the output for the integrator is 0. Okay, when I'm talking about for the output for the integrator, I'm talking right there is 0. Let's go ahead and see how this thing behaves. Before we go into the internal workings of this dual slope conversion, you have to understand the difference between these two diagrams, which I've drawn right here. This resistive capacitive charging network versus this one. At first, the differences are very, very subtle, and I'll point you right to it. It's right here, that ground on one side of the capacitor versus the other one. It does not have a ground. And we'll get back to that second one in a little bit. The first one on the left-hand side here is what we've been used to, where that capacitive voltage will charge up to a certain point at which the current will cease. Whereas the second one here is, look at where this node is right here in this diagram I've drawn. What I'm referring to is this is that particular series path which I've drawn right here, where one end of the capacitor is at VO output, and the other end of the capacitor is at the input of the inverting input of the operational amplifier. What is the first property of an operational amplifier? Well, the inverting and the non-inverting inputs are being held at the same potential. What is the input for the non-inverting, i.e. the one with a plus? Well, it's ground. So what we've got here is a virtual ground, i.e. 0 volts right there. So we can't really use that definition we've been used to, in electronics too at least, to go ahead and figure out how this works. And it's actually surprisingly easy how it works. Because check it out, that capacitor is no longer even a concern, because what is the current through a resistor with voltage on one side and 0 volts on the other? Well, the answer is it's a very constant current. It's I equals Vin divided by R, and that's it. Too simple. The second property of operational amplifiers, things get a little weird here, because we can't have current going to the operational amplifier. Look at this path. Current is going through that resistor. It can't go in the operational amplifier. Where does it do? It goes into the capacitor. How does current keep on flowing in the capacitor to make this happen? Well, right here, this V out, the output for that operational amplifier, what it has to do is it has to continually lower VO with respect to ground, i.e. make it negative for that same current to flow. Pretty neat, huh? Okay, so again, we've got this constant time period. We're allowing it to charge up for that particular piece of time, and what it's doing is successively lowering VO so that constant current can continue to happen. And if we did not have that limited time period for it to go ahead and do that, what would happen here is basically that capacitor is going to keep on charging up and keep on charging up, because it's got that constant current input to it, and it's going to keep on charging up, and basically it's going to do that all day until it explodes into a fiery ball of electrons and shoots electrons everywhere. But we're not going to let that happen. We're just going to go ahead and charge it up for a little bit of time. And the point is here, is that input voltage, if the current is constant and the resistance is constant, because that resistor isn't changing, it has no effect there, it's proportional to that input voltage right there. The higher the input voltage, the greater the current. For example, that's the first time I did it. Let's say that's my first experiment. But then I went to a higher voltage, it would go there. If I went to a lower voltage, it would go there. That's that fixed count variable slope while charging. How are we generating this number right here? Look at the output VO. Okay, as I've mentioned here, let's go back to that single red diagram. It's continually going lower and lower and lower. What's the output for that comparator? Well, the comparator here is seeing negative voltage on its negative input. Its positive input has a zero on it. So yeah, it's happy. It's saying one. True. Negative is always less than ground. It's enabling that clock. The clock will allow that counter to count up to a certain maximum, i.e. this number right here, the fixed time interval, at which point it's going to go ahead and stop. It's going to go ahead and clear the clock, right, get rid of what that counter was, and then the control input is going to do something here. It's going to switch. Which switch right here? It's going to be switching this one. It is no longer hooked to our input voltage. It's hooked to our negative V reference. Okay, things will change now. Let me go ahead and clean up the diagram here. Like I said, we're entering that second stage, a variable count fixed slope while it's discharging. Let me go ahead and clean up the diagram. So what we've got is a situation VO is at a certain negative value proportional to its input value. And what is the output for the comparator there? Well, it's still high, thereby enabling the clock. So we've cleared that out of the counter, and we've done the switch over to the negative reference value, and now we're going to go ahead and see what happens. So we're still enabling that counter. Okay, so the counter starting at zero, and it's going to one, and it's going to two, and so on and so forth. What's happening now is here is this negative reference value. What is the value of the inverting input? Well, it's still virtual ground, 0 volts. So there's still a current, a constant current, i.e. a constant discharge rate. But notice that constant current is in no way, shape, or form affected by this negative V0, the output of the ramp. The only time that negative V0 affects it is how long it takes to discharge. Okay, what I'm saying is, what's the potential difference across our resistor now? Well, it's 0 volts down to negative V reference. So our current, the magnitude at least, should be I equals V reference over R. Notice in there, in that formula, there is no reference to V0. However, think about it. There's a certain limited quantity of charge there for it to drain out. And if it's being drained out at a constant rate, it will take proportionally proportionally longer to drain out that charge. Okay, does that make sense? If Z0 has been brought to an extremely low negative value, it will take longer for it to discharge at a constant rate. And that's what we're doing here, is we're entering that period of a constant slope. It's constantly, it will not change regardless, but this period T is proportional to the value in which it, T1 in this particular case, it's proportional to the magnitude that V0 was originally brought to. The whole time what's happening there is the output for that comparator. If V0 is negative, it's still having a high output for the comparator, and that clock is still going, and that counter is counting and counting up and counting up. It's measuring T1. At a certain point, V0, you know, it's right here, it's right here, it's still lower than one, still lower than zero, still lower than zero. Finally, it's equal to zero, at which point the counter finally says zero. Clock turns off, and our counter basically stops counting. The controller at this point says, okay, you got to zero, enable the register. It's taking that final count value, bringing it down to our digital output. Like I said, a million extra points for the dual slope conversion, because it is especially cunning how it does this. Not a lot of hardware. Yes, it took time. It took constant time to go ahead and generate that variable slope while it was charging, and then it's a variable count for that fixed loop while it was discharging. Okay, this concludes our brief discussion about the analog to digital conversion method known as the dual slope conversion. Let's move on to another method.